on guard. This really isn't a sword. It's a sword fern. But we need to know that because we... Well, hello there. I'm Green Dean, and welcome to my 122nd video here on EatTheWeeds.com. This time about the nephrolepis, the sword fern. You know, decades ago when I moved to Florida, I was quite disappointed to find out that there isn't the seasonal abundance of fiddlehead ferns that you find in northern climates, even though there are about 100 different ferns inside the state. However, among all the ferns, there's about a dozen that have edible roots or usable roots in some way, and this happens to be one of the Nephroleptis cordifolia. Now, it only took me 20 years to figure out, and then the information came from Nepal, near the Himalayas, not here in Flatiron, Florida. Just about everyone knows that fiddleheads, which are the unfurling ferns of spring, ooh, try saying that one 10 times fast, are edible, though they are controversial whether they're good for you or not. You know, there is some research that suggests they cause cancer, but then again, you know, lab rats get cancer pretty easily, and they really force feed them. I think a few fiddleheads every spring are all right. In northern climates, pickling fiddleheads is a rite of spring. In fact, a precious gift was a home canning jar full of fiddlehead greens. Locally, there are 5 sword ferns, but only one has the tuber, which makes it rather convenient. According to contemporary scientific research around the world, there are about 19 species of sword ferns, not 30. And at least 2, the cordifolia and the undulata, have tubers. Now, there may be a third species, or it may be actually just part of the 2 I just mentioned. So there may be 20 instead of 19, but it's in that range. Now, the point is, if you have a nephrolepis with a tuber, no matter where you are in the world, you have an edible tuber. So it makes it rather convenient. You know, you go to a pot, you pull up a sword fern, you take a look. If it's got a tuber, you got something to eat. Here's a nice little stand of sword ferns. They look like swords, don't they? Long, skinny. This particular species is tapered from end to end, on both ends. It's also considered a trash plant by the state of Florida, so digging it up is no problem. So what we're going to do is see what we can find. Well, let's see what we can dig up here. Let's see what kind of trash ferns. They come up fairly easily. Oh yes, now we got a lot of them here. See this? We got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. They're good size. 7 of them here. So here, it's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. There's 7 of those. That's nice. And also right here, I just thought I saw it, is a young one. And when they're young, they're light colored. So there we have. Nice haul off this fern. These are all edible, all watery. Nice treat. You can also throw them in salads and eat them right out of hand. Just brush the dirt off. Or you can even roast them. Now, the first thing you might want to say is, well, you know, these things don't grow anywhere near where I live because I don't live in a pan-tropical area or anything like that. Well, you know, there are sword ferns just about everywhere, particularly inside lobbies and buildings and hotels. They're just, you know, you can find pots of sword ferns just about every place you want to look. So what you need to do is, you need to pull up those ferns and take a look at the bottom. If they're sword ferns and they've got tubers, you've got an edible nephroleptis. But, of course, you have to make sure that the water in the soil has been wholesome if you can possibly do that. Oh, you should do that. Now, these plants are native to the Himalayas and perhaps northern Australia and New Zealand. They were first seen in Florida in 1933, growing along the side of a road. Now, how they got from from Nepal to Florida, who knows? There's a reason why this is called a sword fern. In that, one stem, alternating leaves, but it can add up to quite a lot of fern. This is why they like to use them in a variety of arrangements and all that. So this is all one plant, good size. It's about a yard long. Here we get down to the business end right here. The seeds, the tubers. So let's talk about them for a moment. Move these over here. I got some special little sections here. I'll try not to get separated. So you can see how they grow in the ends here. These are, here's your root or your rhizome. These are called, then we have little roots that come off those called stolons, and off your stolons you get your little tubers. We've got about 5 or 6 of them here. So let's talk about those for a very specific reason.
We'll take a close-up of these in just a moment. Oops. But as you can all see, they're rather little size of marble, and they're on the hairy side. Now, if you take one this size, and you bake it, it comes out into a shriveled little pile like this. Very, very small. However, these are actually chewy and sweet. So, but these are almost all water, so when you bake them, you end up with next to nothing. If you bake small ones for a while, you get like this, very, very soft, but, watch this, they just crush easily into a powder. That powder is actually coffee flavored. Not too bad. Makes a fairly nice drink. Here's another one, just little ones, they just powder up. So if you bake little ones, like at 350 degrees for a half hour, they turn into powder, which you can actually make a beverage out of. If you take larger ones and you bake them for a while, this aroma right here, it is so strong of coffee, it's rather amazing. And too bad we don't have the capacity with all these videos. But if you take one this size and reduce them, you get that, and those become chewy and sweet. Let's take a closer look at these while they're fresh. Okay, let me see if I can pick up a couple here and bring them up into a nice little focus. There you go. See this? They got a little hair on them. You can see there. See that? A little hairy side. Now you can eat them just as they are with that hair on them, or you can rub the hairs off when you go to put them in salads and all, but it's just not worth the effort. See, look at all the hairs on that. And this one's a little soft. Still edible. This one's a nice hard one right there. Look at that. Very nice. And what you do with that is just rub it. When you're done rubbing, most of the hairs off it. And there it is. It's all set to go in your chop up and throw in, or just in your salads. Read it just as it is. By the way, and when they're much younger, you can see they're even smaller and quite green. Look at that. Still edible. So there we have it. Our Nephroleptus tubers.
Here in Eat the Weeds, we itemize. Let's itemize the Nephroleptus cordifolia. Although most sword ferns are quite similar. As you can tell, they're shaped like a sword. Works out pretty well, doesn't it? Yeah. This one happens to be tapered on this end and then tapered on this end. And if it's the right time of year, or the right year too, they'll have little spots in the back, which is really kind of hard to see out here. But they're kidney shaped, which gives you the name Nephroleptus. And of course, they have where the leaf attaches to the stem, there's a little heart shaped growth. And that's where the cordifolia comes from. On ferns, you often have to have microscopic identifications because they're rather difficult. Now, time of year. Actually, year round, wherever they grow, even after frost, they'll still be the tubers in the ground. You can simply dig them up. They can take a little bit of cold weather, but they are pantropical. However, remember, you can find them in pots nearly anywhere. Environment. They like shade, there's no doubt about it. You'll find them growing in the shades of trees, in the shades of houses. Any place where the sun hits a lot, you're not going to find them growing. They prefer slightly dry soil to slightly wet soil, and they'll grow the tubers the best when they're in rich soil. Method of preparation. Well, you can eat them out of hand. Well, here we go. Their flavor is kind of like that of a potato, although they're also a bit earthy. They have the crunch of kind of like a water chestnut, but they're also rather watery. And you can chop them up and throw them in salads. You can throw them in soups. You can even roast them. But if you roast them, make sure you roast them down a bit, or let them cool off before you eat them, because there can be a lot of hot water in here, and the hot water can burn you, so you want to be careful about that. But you can eat them raw, cooked. There's a wide variety, and they're quite nutritious. You can also take the little tubers and boil them just like potatoes. Now when they come out, they actually have got some crunch to them, and they're astringent. In fact, the juice of the tubers are astringent whether you boil them or whether you eat them raw. So they're always on the puckery side. Well, thanks for joining me here in my 122nd video, this time about the sword fern, the ubiquitous sword fern, found around the world, if you know where to look for it. If you want to know more about the sword fern or about 750 other edible plants, you can go to my website, eattheweeds.com. Oh, and if you want to receive my newsletter, send me an email address. So until then, I want you to think green, eat green, live green. Toodles and en garde.